I'm Claudia Catania, and you're listening to Playing On Air. Welcome back, Playing On Air listeners. We are very grateful to have been able to continue production during quarantine by making some of our recordings remotely. As a result, we're happy to now welcome you to the first episode of our fall 2020 season. In spite of everything, and because of extraordinary support from you, our listeners, from our donors, and from artists, we're here each Sunday to bring you 8 brand new episodes starting today with Lucas Hnath's The Courtship of Anna Nicole Smith. Before we get started, a few words about what's coming. Between now and December, you'll be hearing plays that were recorded in many different worlds. A few of our episodes were captured before COVID in our studio or in front of live audiences in actual New York theaters. That feels far away now, I know. But you'll also be hearing some spectacular performances that we've captured remotely by artists in their homes, despite children, pets, ambient inside and outside noise, sometimes huddled under comforters in their hall closets trying to create a noise-free space. At the moment, my husband has the dog and I am comforter-free. I have to hand it to theater people. They find a way. On that note, we're sending love and solidarity to everyone. And to our friends and colleagues, fellow theater artists across the country, we stand by you. And as much as we love audio plays, we're excited to see you on the other side of this, sitting in a very crowded but safe audience. While we wait, on with the show. You're about to hear The Courtship of Anna Nicole Smith, written and directed by OBIE and Steinberg Award winner Lucas Hnath. His plays include The Thin Place, Broadway's Hillary and Clinton, and the recent smash, A Doll's House Part 2. He's joined today by two luminaries, both OBIE winners as well, Quincy Tyler Bernstine of TV's Power and so many astonishing stage performances, and David Patrick Kelly of Twin Peaks and Broadway's Once. And now, The Courtship of Anna Nicole Smith.
Okay, so what I want you to imagine is that the year is 1991, and we are in Texas in a parking lot. We're in a mostly empty parking lot, except that behind me, there's a strip club, and to the left of me is a dumpster. And beyond that dumpster is a Kentucky Fried Chicken. And imagine that smell you smell, that glorious smell, that's Kentucky Fried Chicken. Also, imagine that I am Anna Nicole Smith. And I am 23. And like I said, the year is 1991, we're in a parking lot in Texas. I'm not quite alone because there's a man in a Cadillac car. He's an old man, really, really old. He's like 86. And he's also really, really rich, like richer than you could ever imagine, like billionaire. Billionaire, billionaire, lots of oil money, rich, rich, rich. And his name is J. Howard Marshall. And he's sitting in that Cadillac car. He looks over at me. He smiles. He waves. And then he says,
"Here are the reasons that you should marry me. I have a big house. I have lots of money. I have a dog. I have at least 3 cars and a boat. I have a maid.
I have a kid."
"I know.
I have a kid, Jay. I have a 7-year-old kid." I said to him, "Daniel, do you think that weird rich guy who comes to the club could make our lives better?" And he said that he doesn't like old people. You scare him. He says you give him nightmares. He says he's scared that one night you'll die, and you'll die in the bathtub, and he'll go into the bathroom to pee, and he'll see you dead. He's never seen a dead person, and he doesn't want to anytime soon. So sorry, Jay, but my answer is no.
Oh, well then, crap.
But that's okay. That's okay. Because I've been thinking there's this other girl at the club, and her name is Rocket. She dances in the club, and she's nice. If you wait right here, I'll go inside and fetch her, and maybe she'll like you and you'll like her.
No.
No?
No.
You haven't even met her.
I know what I like. I like you. And I think you like me.
Well, I just like to dance.
You can dance if you want.
Okay, I'll dance. And imagine at this point, Jay turns on his car radio, and what we hear is something like music from a faraway place. And imagine that I start to dance a dance, a simple dance, just swaying back and forth to the music from a faraway place. And I'm dancing. I'm dancing. I'm still dancing, and as I'm dancing, Jay starts to speak.
So now, I am going to woo you.
Okay, sure, why not?
I like how you dance.
Okay, that's nice.
You dance like my wife.
Probably shouldn't mention that.
My wife is dead.
That's creepy.
She died in a car accident.
You're really bad at this.
I have a son. His name is Bob. Bob likes to go to the strip clubs and watch girls dance. And Bob came to me and said, "Hey, Dad, there's a girl at the strip club who looks like Mom." So I came down to the club to check this girl out. The girl was you. And Bob was right. You look like my dead wife when she was young and alive.
All right, Jay, turn off the music.
Did that not woo you?
This is wrong and weird, and I gotta go. I told Daniel I'd buy him a Happy Meal before I come home if he'd been good. And he's been good, and I wouldn't want to disappoint him.
I'll keep coming back.
Then I'll have you arrested for following me when I don't want to be followed.
You followed me.
You don't understand what you're dealing with.
Then explain it to me what I'm dealing with, so I can think about it and decide whether or not I want to be dealing with what I'm dealing with.
Okay, then. Back when I was a kid, my mother took me to see a fortune teller for my 12th birthday. Her name was Madame Lorraine. She lived in a shack out behind a farm. I went into the shack. My mother had to wait outside. Madame Lorraine shut the door, called upon her spirit guide, and began speaking in the language of the spirits. After about 15 minutes of this, she held up two fingers and she said, "Two paths." She said that when I'm in my 20s, I will reach two paths. On one path would be an old man in a Cadillac car who plays music from a faraway place. He would offer me his hand in marriage. And if I chose the path of the man in the Cadillac car, I would get money and I would get fame and I would be known by everyone in the world. But it would also all be a blur. The world would move fast, and when I least expect it, at a very young age, bang, I would die a tragic death. And then Madame Lorraine held up her second finger and said that the other path wouldn't look like much. I'd have my family, I'd work a lot, I'd watch TV, and sometimes I'd drink a beer. Oh, I'd be sad at times, and sometimes I might be a little happy. But I'd live a real normal life. I wouldn't be special except for times when I tell myself that I'm something special. No one would know who I am except for the people right around me, like my kid and maybe a boyfriend and the people that I work with. And I'd live. I'd live until I was old, real old, like as old as you are, and then I'd die. Two paths, Jay, and I don't know which one to pick. I know I'm supposed to want the boring life, but I'd rather have the fast life. I want the fast life, except that I'm scared. Scared for myself and scared for my kid. Jay, are you dead?
Not yet. I was just thinking, is all.
About?
How I don't believe in fortune tellers.
What do you believe in then?
Money. Money tells a fortune. And if you don't like your fortune, then you can use the money to change it. Soon there will be a time when the people who have all of the money will be able to live forever. And the people who don't, won't. Will you marry me?
No. No, I won't marry you. But maybe next Friday you can come back and maybe ask me again. And maybe I'll say no again.
You just heard The Courtship of Anna Nicole Smith, written and directed by Lucas Hnath. It featured Quincy Tyler Bernstine and David Patrick Kelly. And the music you're hearing right now is Amari C by the Underscore Orchestra. Special thanks to Actors Theatre of Louisville, where this play was first produced in 2010 as part of the TENS, presented by the Professional Training Company. I am looking forward to talking about today's play. Short in length, but dense in matter. We are with Lucas Hnath, its playwright and director, Quincy Tyler Bernstine, and David Patrick Kelly, informally known as DP. Hi.
Hello.
Hi.
Hello.
Lucas, you note in the script that where the play takes place is wherever the play is happening, whenever the play is happening, and though it features a famous real-life 86-year-old billionaire who wants to marry a real-life 23-year-old stripper, quote, there should be no attempt to imitate the actual people on which this play is based. Can you explain the why of all these choices to our listeners?
I had been thinking about being interested in writing plays about celebrities that made zero attempt to impersonate the celebrity. And you know that the audience is going to bring in a lot of baggage and received images and notions about the famous person. And then what happens if you write a play that refuses to meet any of those expectations? You get a kind of interesting tension. And it's not a new idea at all. It was very much influenced by Adrian Kennedy's Movie Star Has to Star in Black and White, and Jeffrey M. Jones wrote a play called Dirty Little Secrets that was about famous people that didn't really attempt to impersonate those famous people. I mean, similarly, another one that I completely forgot about and remembered last night was Matt and Ben, the Mindy Kaling, Brenda Withers play that, Quincy, you were in. So,
what made you think of that?
It just popped into my head. Well, I was trying to remember, when did I first see you? And actually, that wasn't the first time. I saw you in a friend's reading. I don't even remember what the reading was, but I asked somebody, oh my God, who is that actress? She's extraordinary.
That's nice.
And then from that point on, I was just like following you. So but I was trying to remember the origin story of how I first encountered you, and that popped back into my brain. But there is a kind of cartoonish image of Anna Nicole Smith that I always kind of found a little disturbing, and thought there has to be more going on than that. Like, it's this two-dimensional billboard that's standing in front of a real person that's behind it. And as opposed to, you know, tr- try to psychologize her too much. I thought it's more interesting to just sort of play with the image in a way that does not, you know, replicate the cartoon. So that's how this play came about. And then I went on to write a number of other plays pretty soon after that did similar things. My play about Hillary Clinton, my play about Walt Disney, a play about Isaac Newton. All of them were playing with similar ideas.
Right, right. So Quincy, what went through your mind when you were first asked to play Anna Nicole Smith?
Well, I said yes immediately because it's Lucas and I would do anything for him. I had a feeling that I wouldn't actually be playing Anna Nicole Smith, but I was just thrilled to participate. I mean, I love working on Lucas's stuff, so I knew that I would have a good time.
What did the three of you discuss in the very first read-throughs?
I mean, we covered kind of some of the basics of not attempting to impersonate the characters, but at the same time, it's something that with DP and Quincy, I feel very little need to discuss, you know, both of you being actors who traffic brilliantly in non-literal work.
Very kind of you to say. There's something that you get attached to those things, you know, and I've always been a student of poetic drama. And so the beautiful flow in Lucas' writing is incredible, you know, and that kind of helix-like interweaving of the two characters, you know, in this kind of nowhere world of a parking lot in Texas, you know. And then these are two souls reaching out for something transcendent.
Lucas, I love how you distill your dialogue to like 110 proof. Short plays are by definition distillations. Do you like this genre?
I find it very difficult. I haven't written many. I've written maybe two or three or four short plays. And one of the reasons why I wrote this play was I felt like I could never quite figure out the 10-minute play. I wasn't quite sure what is the right amount of action. And so I decided, well, the trick to writing a 10-minute play is to write a 7-minute play. So I endeavored to write a 7-minute play. Something about seven seemed right. Like the right number.
Yeah. Didn't Hemingway say that novelists are failed short story writers? Something like that.
I did.
And just from Quincy and DP, what are those challenges? If you have so few words and they're unadorned, is that a challenge in terms of telling the story?
Well, I think I'll go to Hemingway again, you know, which is he had that thing called the iceberg theory of literature, which means that what you don't say is just all the stuff beneath the surface.
Mm-hmm, you know? Absolutely.
You know, so I think choosing these kind of mountainous characters, you know, there's tons there that you don't need to say.
Exactly. Yeah. And I'm all for economy. You know, I try to be economical in my work in general and full-length plays and everything that I do. So I sort of appreciate the distillation, as you said earlier.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah. Both Jay and Anna's sons, which are mentioned in Lucas's play, they're drawn so well with so few lines. Any of you have comments about those characters and why they appear and how they reflect on the main characters?
There's a beautiful balance between her child and he says, I have a son. I have a son too. And he's the one who led me here. There's an incredible balance in the children there.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And also that Daniel, her son, seems to me to be the center of her world. And she's, you know, making these decisions not only for her, but for her son. So
I think one of the reasons why I was drawn to write about Anna Nicole Smith was that my mother was kind of obsessed with her. Anytime there was some kind of gossipy news story about her, she would call me up and like, did you hear about this? Did you hear about this? I thought it was kind of fascinating that she was so interested in her. And so when Anna Nicole Smith died, I was actually in a post office and there was like a television screen in the post office and I saw it on the screen and I felt incredibly sad, as though something terrible had happened to my mother. Like I had kind of conflated the two people. And the way in which Anna Nicole talks about Daniel resembles very much how my mother would talk about me, about how, you know, when we didn't have much money, it was a big deal to go to McDonald's. Mm. And so it's very much me sort of actually using these other people's stories to talk about my mother and me.
Is that the surprising part when you're writing along there and you suddenly you write something that's happened in your own life?
It's funny. It's either a surprise, right? So you've written from this sort of like primordial ooze place and then something slips out. And then sometimes actually it becomes the way of taking it personally. Mm. So I'll say, okay, I'm not writing about Anna Nicole Smith. I'm writing about me and my mother.
Right. Mm-hmm.
And then that takes me into the ooze.
Is it easy to keep that in, or do you want to, sometimes that's too close to the bone?
I think with me, I can never get too close to the bone. I'm so, I live in the realm of reason and explanation and making everything make sense. My objective is to figure out some way to trick myself into slipping and falling into the ooze.
Anna believes she talks about a choice that the fortune teller, Madame Lorraine, predicted when she was 12.
Mm-hmm.
Choose path number one and you'll be rich and you'll be famous, but you'll die young and tragically. Or path number two and you'll live an average, normal, somewhat boring, but long life with family. And Anna rejects the first choice at the start of the play and sort of at the end of the play. Whereas we know the real Anna Nicole Smith married Jay.
Mm-hmm.
Why do y'all think Lucas ends the play where he does?
Lucas.
Leave him wanting more. Yeah, no, leave him wanting more. No,
that's exactly it. That's exactly it.
Yeah.
I was the kid who would watch 2001 Space Odyssey, and I would feel both exhilarated and agitated by the ending, which sort of drops you off a cliff. I like to sort of end my plays in a moment of impasse or decision. It can feel abrupt, and I kind of like that because it makes the brain have to try to finish the sentence. I've heard the anecdote that the way Chopin would wake up in the morning is he would have somebody in the house play an unresolved chord on the piano, and that would wake him up instantly because he needed to go run and resolve the chord. And I like prompting the brain to leap into action as opposed to go back to sleep. And because I also know that either option would be kind of disappointing.
Right, yeah. Right.
Yeah. Do you think everybody deep inside, if they listen, has like an inner Madame Lorraine laying out their choices?
Do you know Bobby Blue Bland? Remember Turn On?
Yeah.
Further on up the road, somebody's gonna hurt you like you hurt me. That's Bobby Blue Bland. He was a great blues man and singer and R&B guy. Most known for Turn On Your Love Light, Let It Shine On Me. Turn On Your Love Light. Well, I had a choice between two jobs, and I was walking down the street. I was going to work with the Wooster Group, or I was going to do a musical at Lincoln Center, and I could not decide which one to do. I went to an old folks' home on Fifth Avenue, and there was an old guy sitting out in front in a rocking chair. And I said, "Sir, I always visit my mother, and she'd give me wise advice." I said, "I got these two jobs. What should I do?" He said, "Do what you do best. Do what you do best." And I said, "Thank you, sir. What did you do in life?" He said, "I'm Bobby Blue Bland."
Oh, wow.
"I'm Bobby Blue Bland." And I chose the musical because the Wooster Group didn't have health insurance at that time. It was a right choice. It got me into Once and everything else. But I went back to visit Calvin, is his real name, Bobby Blue Bland, and he was gone.
Oh.
So it was one of those fork in the road kind of moments, you know, with the spiritual advisor right there on the road when you need him.
Wow, what a story.
Yeah.
Lucas, how close or far away does this play feel to the writer you are now?
A little bit of both. Yeah, I mean, this play was definitely a turning point play, and it was the first time that a theater that was an institution, a professional theater, decided to put on one of my plays. And it was also, you know, the person who pulled the play out of the reject pile was Sarah Lunny, who was at the time an associate literary manager and has been with me as a collaborator for most of my plays. She's one of my primary collaborators. Yeah, I mean, I went back and looked at the play for the first time in a long time before this session, and I did some tweaks. I made some adjustments. Some of it was about translating it to radio. Some of it was about choices of rhythm or, you know, language choices that I wasn't so fond of anymore. I look at it and I can sort of critique the dramaturgy of it in a way that I don't think I would have, you know, back in 2007. But, you know, it's interesting coming into this recording session, the way in which the writer I am now is part of the conversation and influencing me to make choices that I wouldn't have made then. You know, like, I don't know if this is giving away a secret now, but the opening section, I was perfectly happy to say to Quincy, well, you've read it a couple of times, now just make it up. And I don't think that would have ever occurred to me in 2007. I mean, the amount of control that I wanted over every single word, and there's still some of that, but I also am very excited about the possibility of the things that I can't control.
You were really good, director Lucas.
Excellent.
Aww. Speaking of director, Lucas, have you ever directed before?
Yeah, I always direct the first couple of workshops of all of my plays. And I do think likely I'll direct one of the full lengths in production. But one of the reasons why I haven't yet is I fear it being far too lonely. You know, it's really nice to have a director pal that you really sort of can become a two-bodied, one-headed beast with. Feel like I've been very lucky to have that with many people and many times over and over with Les Waters.
It's been fascinating having you three here. We've been talking with the playwright and director of The Courtship of Anna Nicole Smith, Lucas Hnath, and Quincy Tyler Bernstine, who played Anna, and David Catcher Kelly, who played J. Howard Marshall. Thank you, thank you, thank you.
Thank you. I just want to say this quickly. Like, this has made me miss acting. None of us have really gotten to do this in so many months, and this has made me like really, really excited to get back and do this.
Yeah.
So thank you.
Thank you.
Yes.
You said it. You've been listening to Playing on Air, Great American Short Plays with Great American Actors. Associate producer, Michelle O'Brien. Literary manager, Bonnie Antosh. Literary assistant, Aditya Pratama. Marketing and communications manager, Shelley Horwitz. Theme music, Tom Cochan. Recording and sound design, John Kilgore. Audio editing, Michelle O'Brien. Playing on Air is distributed by PRX, Public Radio Exchange. For Playing on Air, I'm your host, Claudia Catania. Thanks for listening.